I hate to break the fishing news up here, M-Chuck, but I'd like to speak about the ice hockey.
Congratulations. You're one of the 13 listeners of the Real Life Podcast.
We just traded a migraine in for, like, an orgasm.
Might want to mark that down,
Yep. All of my projects are on schedule until they're not.
A member of the Nation Network of Podcasts.
About as funny as we're going to get today.
Welcome in, Nation Real Life Podcast. It's our Thursday edition. I'm Tyler Yaremchuk. We got a bit of a shortened staff today, or shortened squad. No Wanye, no Chalmers, but Jay is here. Bag Milk is here. As always, this podcast is brought to you by our friends over at Japa Machinery. They didn't ask me anything on their Instagram the other day. Go check it out. They had some pretty cool answers in there, including like they ranked or had the coolest projects they ever worked on. Rogers Place was included in there. Thought that was super neat. But always check out our friends over at Japa doing great stuff with big equipment. And now I bring in a couple men who are also doing great stuff with big equipment. That's a creepy intro, but Bag Milk, Jay, how are you guys doing?
Loaded statement. Doing great.
Yeah, I'd also question me doing good stuff with my big equipment.
Another week in isolation for the Real Life gang. So we are on FaceTime again, and we talked, the three of us actually talked about this yesterday, but with us being in isolation and everyone on the phone, we are making an attempt, and this is something that will make me happy and Wanye not so happy, to get this podcast a little more structured. So we're bringing back some segments, and that starts today a little bit later on in the podcast. We're bringing back Keeping It 100.
You got a rant in you there, Tyler?
I do.
Normally this would normally be Chalmers' time to shine, but he's not here today. He's got things going on with a real job. I am curious to see what kind of anger you've got bubbling up in you.
I have a couple of them. So I'm going
to... Well, we might have to keep it 102 then.
Yeah, I might need to go twice, or maybe I need to save one for next week. But I got a couple that I have locked and loaded. We'll see which one I go with. But I like the idea of having some more segments, just kickstarting more conversations. I think this podcast loves to get off the rails. I love when it gets off the rails, but as I always say, it needs to be on the rails to start.
Do you though? Your mouth said you like it, but I know your heart says something else.
You guys are looking
part
at
part of this podcast charm. Sorry, part of this podcast charm is that it does get off the rails, but it's also nice to let it do that. But you know, also kind of, you know, have some elements that people can rely on every week that they're going to hear from us. And hopefully we can deliver and keep that structure on the rails for you, Tyler.
We're going to be Keeping It 100, brought to you by Nation Beer. We'll have a Nation Beer update a little bit later on in the podcast. And Mondays, we're going to do listener questions. We're going to kind of open up like we do on the site, Monday mailbag here, where you can hit us up on Instagram or Twitter, shoot us a DM, comment on a photo, whatever you need. And we'll be answering your questions. And when we talked about this yesterday, I mean, if it's a hockey question for myself or Bag Milk, a business question for Jay or Wanye, or maybe you're doing a home reno like I kind of am, and you have big questions for Chalmers, this podcast can cover a lot of ground when it comes to listener questions. So I'm excited for that.
We're here to help. Whatever that help looks like, but it's here.
Yeah, and it may not be the best advice, but it will definitely be advice.
Exactly.
I'm feeling lonely right now because, Jay, you're driving while we're doing this. Bag Milk's camera is off, so I'm on the FaceTime just looking at myself. But, yeah, we got a bunch of topics to get to today. And you know what? Maybe we'll start with this. The Michael Jordan documentary is creating a lot of buzz. It's the whole documentary of that Bulls team. It's called The Last Dance. It's going to air on a streaming service in the next week or so here. But it's supposed to be like the unvarnished truth, exactly what happened following that Bulls team sort of step for step throughout that entire season. So my question is, if you guys could get the straight up 100% truth, if you could be in the walls, in the locker room, doing a full-on documentary about any team in Oilers history, which team would it be? And I'll start with you, Bag Milk. I know I'm not giving you a ton of time to think about this one. Like, I have three or four in my head, but I want to know, like, what's the first team that kind of jumps to the front of your brain?
So, when you first mentioned this before we started, my initial thought was to go back to the 80s teams. Mm-hmm. But then I kind of remembered, I've seen Boys on the Bus a whole bunch of times. So I feel like, I mean, it's not going to be you know, a multi-part series like the Jordan thing will be. But I think that I want to change gears. I want to go to a team like maybe the 97 Oilers team that beat Dallas in game seven. Do you know what I mean? They were such an underdog team that nobody expected them to win that. And then Todd Marchand goes out and scores that infamous goal in overtime to send them through. That'd be super interesting. Or if I'm selfish and I want to know about my boy Nuge and Connor McDavid, I'd also love to know about the team that got the Oilers back into the playoffs for the first time in more than a decade from 2017. I'd love to see how that whole run came together, all the bits and pieces in the dressing room, what it's like having Connor as, you know, as the captain the first year as at Rogers Place. All of that stuff would be super interesting to me.
Jay, do you have a take on that one team?
Yeah, well, like the 80s Oilers would be so interesting to see, because this is pre-social media. This is when the media is partying with the team, so all the secrets are kept secret. Like, those guys, like, you hear whispers of stories of how wild they were during, you know, when they're just crushing Stanley Cups. That, like, to me, like, we see boys on the bus, but that is so sanitized. Like, it would be unreal to see how crazy of a time these guys had, because you hear rumblings of, like, they were animals, and it would be wild to see that. But if I wanted to go a little bit more new era, it would probably be the 06 team, because that was a team that had, like, young and old. So the young were, like, the Raffy Torreses and the Jared Stolls, and I know those guys were living their best lives out on the town, but it would be interesting to see, like, how that whole room dynamic was evolving while they kept getting deeper and deeper into the playoffs, because the Oilers went from a team, like, we signed Pronger and Pekka going into that year, crazy news. Like, I thought that was the craziest thing to happen in Oilers history at the time. And, you know, we squeak into eighth spot. So, like, kind of like watching how the room and the team starts, like, gelling throughout the season and finds itself right at the right time and gets hot on a long playoff run. And then also for the cherry on top, I would love to know the real reason why Pronger left.
That would be spicy, because, you know, like, obviously anybody who's been a long-term Oilers fan or a hardcore knows all the rumors we're not going to get into, but, like, that, I would love to know what went down there. I would also love to see more in depth, if we're looking at 2006, more in depth on some of the moves that Kevin Lowe made that year, bringing in old tricky Dick Tarnstrom, old Spotcheck, Samsonov at the deadline, Rolly. Like, there's so many big moves there that I would love to have been a fly on the wall just to kind of hear the genesis of how those all worked out.
Yeah, that's a good point. Like, figuring out, like, when or how he got the green light to go all in. Cause, like, those were fucking, like, the multiple moves and huge moves that he made.
I think that might be the most interesting part. Like, and wouldn't that be a cool, like, start to a documentary on that team if you have, like, the war room footage of Kevin Lowe sitting there with all his scouts and other executives being like, we're going all in. Like, we're going to make this move for Pronger. And, like, you know, you think back, you remember that clip that's now gone viral of, like, Shirelli when he's trading Tyler Seguin, right? It's like that, but in reverse. Like, would there be any executives who were like, we can't do this, it's too risky, or something like that? Be right. The war room footage of, like, even the trade deadline acquiring Rolison, being inside the locker room as they built up down that run down the stretch. The 06 team would be incredibly fascinating.
Because they, like, just thinking about, again, going into the war rooms, the Oilers traded a first round pick for Rolison that year. And I remember thinking, even at the time as a 21-year-old or whatever, I was like, wow, they're trading a first-round pick for a goalie in his late 30s or mid to late 30s, and you're just like, what's going on? So the footage about how that came in, and maybe, like you said, Tyler, maybe there were scouts that said, I don't know if you want to trade a pick that high for a goalie. We don't even know if we're going to get in and all that kind of thing. It'd be amazing. Incredible.
Yeah, and like you said, you're getting the 100% truth here, which is something that'd be interesting with that 80s team. Like, anyone who's lived in Edmonton for a duration of their lives has heard rumors about that club and all that stuff. And, like, to get the 100% answers on that would just be, it would be probably be mind blowing. And same thing with that 06 team. Like, you mentioned Pronger leaving, but not just him, like, all of those free agents who kind of dipped out after that 1 year. Like, what was the story behind a lot of those guys? What was that team like in the room? Like, you always hear stories, and I'm not saying this is the case at all, but like the Oakland A's of the 80s, who are 80s and 90s, who like some of those teams fucking hated each other. Like, they would just fight in the clubhouse and they couldn't stand each other. Like, throughout any of these Oilers teams, like, you would get to see all of that shit. You'd get to see blowups in the room that were like never made public and all that. But 06 would definitely be great. How about this, if you want blowups in the room and chaos? What about the Dallas Eakins season?
Oh, that'd be great. Like, that year and change that he was around would have been fantastic. Because first it starts off with him benching Nail Yakupov.
Yeah.
Right? And then the whole water thing with Taylor Hall later on in the season, taking away the ping pong table that had been there for decades. All of that stuff would be fantastic.
Yeah, like the whole Eakins era. Sorry, go ahead, Jay.
Yeah, and I'd like to be a fly on the wall in the in the draft room leading up to the Yakupov pick.
Yeah.
Well, I've been thinking about that recently because Brian Burke did an interview on Spit and Chicklets where he talked about one of their scouts. He was in Toronto at the time, saying that he almost wanted to fight Yak for how bad his interview was. But I also feel a little bit like we're rewriting history at times when it comes to the 2012 draft, because he was, at the time, the consensus number one.
And
do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and Burke in that same interview, like, I think this is revisionist history with Burke, and he goes in that interview on Spit and Chicklets, and he's like, oh, I never tell a story unless it's true. But he says they wouldn't have taken Yakupov, even if he was there at fifth, because they worst draft interview ever, blah, blah. And then he goes, yeah, and you know, we had Morgan Riley as our number one prospect in that entire draft, and we were lucky to get him at five. And it's like, did you really have Morgan Riley as your number one prospect? Or are you just sitting here trying to sound like the smartest guy in the room because, oh yeah, we picked him at five and he was ranked number one and we hated Yakupov from day one. We never thought he'd be good. Like, to me, this reeks of Brian Burke, like, stroking his own ego.
Well, and there's, like, again, like, I remember very clearly that draft was all about Yakupov or Ryan Murray. Like, those were the top two choices. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
So I just feel, especially with 2012, because there aren't a whole lot of players in that top chunk of the draft that really, really panned out. I just feel that there's so much revisionist history in terms of that one specifically.
You know, the first overall pick is like being dealt pocket aces in poker. Like, it's fucking a gift and a curse. And yeah, you're forced to pick the best player available. But I honestly, I would take a lot of waiting in those interviews. And if Nail Yakupov interviewed horrifically, I would use that as a strike against in terms of translating his ability in junior into ability at the NHL level. But
I also wonder too, like, was there also some kind of lost in translation moments in there? Because if you remember when Yak came in, he barely spoke English.
Yeah.
So was there some kind of Russian translation that was going on in there, Russian to English, or just he was trying to answer in English? I don't know. I just remember Yakupov as like one of the sweetest kids in the community ever when he was here. So it's almost, it's like a weird thing to think of him saying anything in a scouting interview that would cause a scout to want to fight him.
And also the point I saw made on this was like, Yakupov was sort of, like you said, the consensus one, and if he wasn't one, he was going two. No one had him dropping further than two. Why were the Leafs interviewing this guy? Like, that might have been part of Yakupov might have been like, I'm very busy. Why do I have to sit in this room for an hour while Brian Burke grills me about my fucking eating habits and how much I passed the puck in junior? Like, he might have just been like a little ticked off of that. I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but like some insight into why that draft interview may have gone so sideways.
Well, maybe you want to trade up.
Yeah, I guess maybe, but man, just back to the point. If you could have, again, been a fly on the wall for the Oilers draft interviews with Yak, and they're in the war room when they're debating who to take, and I mean, there's always that rumor going around that, you know, Daryl Cate said you're taking Yakupov, you're taking the exciting goal scorer. We would find out if that's true in this hypothetical.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also think the Taylor or Tyler debate probably would have been super interesting from 2010 as well. Like, I remember that one coming down to the wire and having no idea who the Oilers were going to take up until the point when they went up onto the stage.
Yeah, I didn't know what I was cheering for. I didn't. I think I was actually leaning towards Sagan.
I think I was too, actually. I think I remember going back to then. Granted, I was, you know, fairly young, but I remember thinking and reading stuff, being like, they need the center. You take the center. You always take a franchise center. Mm-hmm. Going back to that draft too, after Hall and Sagan, things fell off in a hurry for those teams. Like, Eric Gudbranson went third. Ryan Johansson was actually a fine player who ended up going fourth. Nino Niederreiter got good, but it took him two trades to get there. Brett Connolly, sort of the same thing. Like, Alex Burmistrov went in that top 10. Dylan McIlrath hasn't even played a full season in the league, and I don't think ever will now at this point.
He played for the Moose Jaw Warriors. I love Dylan McIlrath.
He was, yeah. I was just actually looking at that. A good Moose Jaw boy. A lot of revisionist history sort of with that 2012 draft. But back to the point, I think getting a chance to follow around that Yakupov Aikens era team with Hall and, like, that would have been the year where, you know, Eric Bélanger was, like, saying shit in the media, right, about how, like, Yakupov should be sliding. Like, there was the slide down the ice. Like, that whole event would have been fascinating as well. I think that team, it honestly might be my answer, just because there's so many interesting storylines that would come out of it.
Well, and then you would get the little snippet of the Todd Nelson a couple months where he just came in and just, like, he would be out every, like, you'd hear stories of him out in public every night just having, like, beers, and he was just on a vacation. And he got the room so loose that the team actually started playing good.
I always thought it was a massive mistake that, I know we're getting deep into Oilers talk on the Real Life podcast, but I always felt like it was a mistake that Todd Nelson never gotten an NHL look here in Edmonton.
I did too, especially with the way that, like Jay just said, with the way that that season ended, because it almost seemed like once they started to get loose and once Todd Nelson started doing his thing that maybe they could build upon that the following year, but obviously not meant to be. How about one of the I was thinking about this the other day as well. One of the forgotten stories of that era is when Mac T was on the bench. Remember that for a couple of games?
Yeah. When he babysat Todd Nelson?
That was the best. Mac T coming out of the press box to survey on the bench. I loved it. He was there for, what, 3-4 games or something? It was so funny. Peak Oilers, that was.
Oh, yeah.
That's not completely, because who did that? Bob Murray did that in Anaheim, right? Where he decided, he was like, fuck it, I'm going to coach this team. And he did both jobs. He decided to actively coach the team for the rest of the year to, like, get a read on his room and shit. I always think that's completely insane. I think the Devils did that this year as well. Didn't they, like, send Tom Fitzgerald onto the bench or something like that to, like, babysit their head coach before they fired him?
I think something like that. And I've got visions of, like, Lou Lamoriello being a coach too.
I'm still waiting for the Slapshot-esque player coach after somebody gets fired. I'm still waiting to see that.
But Connor McDavid should be the player coach, for Christ's sakes.
Yeah, just give Tip a couple of days off and Connor runs the show.
Well, actually, yeah, I can't shit on Tip. I fucking love Tip.
Yeah, if this was a few years ago, maybe we'd get away with saying that, but just talking about Todd Nelson, that was weird how, like, when that season ended, Nelson and McTavish were the duo. And they basically got the short end of the stick because the Oilers won the lottery and then immediately flipped into the what we thought was going to be the dynamic duo of McClellan and Shirelli.
Yeah, I remember.
Even just when Peter Chiarelli got hired, I remember being so nervous because I had seen that clip of trading Sagan. And then as it turns out, you know, he hadn't learned a whole lot.
And he never will. We're about 20 minutes into the Real Life podcast. Jay, Tyler Rumchuk, Bagged Milk here. Before we get into keeping it 100, an interesting thing popped up online. It seems like, I don't know if bromance is the right word, but something's budding here between Alex Ovechkin and Wayne Gretzky, and they're going to play like an NHL tournament against each other. Then they're going to do, you were saying, Bagged Milk, some sort of like sit-down interview with just the two of them as well. This is cool.
Yeah, so I just covered this, OilersNation.com. Gretzky and Ovi on April 22nd will be doing a best-of-three battle in NHL 20. They're going to stream it through the Capitals Twitch account. And the whole goal of this is to raise money for both the Edmonton Food Bank and Washington's Feed the Frontlines, which also provides meals for those in need. So it's for a great cause. But like you said, Tyler, they've got a little budding bromance going on. And on the 20th, they are going to be sitting down for kind of an at-length discussion as part of the Hockey from Home campaign that's going on right now. And they're going to talk about Ovechkin's pursuit of Gretzky's goal record. They're going to talk about when Gretzky sent Ovi, and I love this, by the way, mm-hmm. when Gretzky sent Ovi one of those classic silver Eastons from the 90s after he won the Stanley Cup a couple years ago in Washington. And it's just super cool to see two of the best ever kind of joining. And of course, Gretzky is so magnanimous and so gracious in terms of his record, whereas I personally would be selfish and being like, I don't want anybody to touch my records. But Gretzky sees it as good for the game. So it's just really interesting to see two of the best that ever played kind of building a relationship and using that to further the game. I like it.
What if in this NHL 20 match, maybe Gretzky isn't so pumped for him to break his record and he tries to hurt digital Ovechkin to send a message?
It could be. Well, I thought it was, my concern though is this, according to the Washington Post, Scott Allen, this idea was spurned after Gretzky saw a video of Ovi playing video games with his son. And Gretzky thought that it would be a nice thing for the two of them to do to raise some money. My concern is, it's clear that Ovi is an active gamer. How often does old Uncle Wayne get a chance to sit down and play some Chell?
He's gonna Milli Vanilli it.
Scandalous!
Milli Vanilli it. He's got a rep. Oh yeah, it's gonna happen.
You think maybe like Ty Gretzky is gonna be in the background somewhere playing for his pops?
Hell yeah.
Gotta make
Wayne look good. Gotta make Wayne look good.
And I also want to know which...
If Ovi just beats him like 12-0.
That's the thing. Like he's going to want to prove a point. Like, the interesting thing about Ovi, right, is he wants to be the best so bad. So, like, he wants to be the best Russian, right? Like, so I'd watch, like, he wants to be the best player, but, like, he also wants to be the best Russian. Because I remember watching a game, and the Caps are playing the Pens. And Ovi was running around trying to murder Malkin. And I'm like, that's his boy. So I asked the guy who's connected to the team, and I'm like, why does Ovi keep running Malkin? He's like, oh, it's because he wants to be the best Russian. So he wants to show that he's stronger. He wants to take out his, you know, counterparts. And so that's why he'll go around and do that. So he's a crazy competitive dude.
But I mean, like, I feel like to get to where Ovechkin is at, same with Connor, you have to be crazy competitive and ultra, like, you will step on somebody's head to get to the next step kind of thing. And I feel like the greatest of all time, those players, you have to be like that.
100%.
Yeah, like, I would love nothing more than Connor McDavid to run over and annihilate Austin Matthews. That would be amazing.
He does in spirit, though.
Oh, he does a lot of ways outside of just hitting him. He does psychologically, on the scoreboard, you know, with the hardware, like, he's winning the battle. But
amongst his own fan base.
Yeah, amongst his own fan base. One thing, like, that, yeah, I felt like it was just, I was blown away. I didn't know it went this far. Is Gretzky doing this on behalf of the Edmonton Food Bank?
Yeah. Yeah. So
Holy fuck. That's unreal.
Yeah, it's the best. So Gretzky is working to raise some funds for the Edmonton Food Bank, whereas Ovi has got Feeding the Frontlines from Washington. So both guys sticking kind of in their playing cities, if you will.
We are so lucky to have guys like Wayne Gretzky come through our town and still support us.
Well, that's what I was just
and
about
love
to say.
The city.
Is like... Of, you know, we give Daryl Cates a ton of love on this podcast, but there are portions of the fan base that don't like him. What he did to sort of get Wayne Gretzky back into the fold, not just with the Oilers, but with the entire NHL, like, there was a while there, and it wasn't talked about a lot, but there was a feud going. Wayne did really not want anything to do with the league, and there was a process in getting him back involved, not just with the Oilers, but with anything to do with the NHL. And it's been a really cool storyline to follow pretty much since that 16-17 playoff run, maybe a little bit earlier, of Wayne getting more involved back in front of the camera a little bit, more involved back in Edmonton as well, like doing this for the Edmonton Food Bank. It's fascinated me, and it's heartwarming.
It also really makes me miss playoff Gretzky, remember? Yeah. Like when something would happen and you see him on TV and he is feeling everything that all of us are feeling at that same moment.
He was my spirit animal during the playoffs. Like, fuck, he got me going.
The gifts were unreal.
I have a bunch. Speaking of gifts, I was cleaning up my laptop because the old girl's starting to get a little bit full and run out of space. So I was cleaning up some of the old stuff, and I've got so many great playoff Gretzky gifts in a folder that I had just found that I hadn't seen forever. And there's literally something for every occasion. There's happy Wayne. There's dejected Wayne. There's visibly looking angry Wayne. I love it all.
Moving to the next topic here, but sticking sort of on video games, I read an article the other day of a guy from Yahoo Sports who he basically created a team of all Mike Trouts. So the batting order was just a bunch of 99 overall Mike Trouts in the video game. But he also copied his pitching stats, which are just brutal because he's a position player trying to pitch. So it was a team of 99 overall hitting Mike Trouts, but then Mike Trout having to pitch for this team as well. He simulated a season, and the team was, like, fucking terrible. They only won 14 of their 162 games. And where I'm going with this, and it's a conversation I had earlier this week as well, but what if, we can even make this about real life, if you had a team of all Connor McDavids, you had four lines, center, left wing, right wing, all Connor McDavid, defense was six Connor McDavids, you had three Connor McDavids in the press box, but Connor McDavid also had to play in net with his current skill level. How good would that team do?
I don't think they would do well. No. I think this is the Rangers in the late 90s, early 2000s, before the salary cap, when they could just throw $9 million at Bobby Hajdúk. It's just, you need a mix. You need a mix of dudes. And while the top 12 of all Connor McDavids would be absolutely dominant, the defensive side of the puck and, of course, in net is where you would really struggle.
Oh, but we would dominate possession. Like, right? If we have the puck, we will fucking dominate. But you could literally pull the, who was it? Oh, the Dougie Hamilton on Mikko Koskinen maneuver on Connor McDavid and net like five times a game.
Yeah, you'd be ripping clappers at Connor from everywhere.
Yeah, so it would be high scoring because best believe Connor's going to fucking bring the offense.
Though I also, now that I'm thinking about it, I also wouldn't be surprised if McDavid goalie Connor McDavid is also just as good because he is so competitive that he spends literally every waking moment practicing being a goaltender.
And that's actually conversation eventually went was, okay, preseason game 1 through 5 of the regular season, they would probably lose their games like 15-8 and like 15-9 and all that. But by like Christmas, January, Connor McDavid's work ethic, his God-given natural ability, his pure athleticism, how much better would he get? Like, would he drop his goals against average from, say, 15 to like 9 by January? And then by like February, he'd be down to like 6 and you'd be winning games 8-6 all of a sudden? And where this conversation...
You know what? Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Fuck, I didn't even think about that. If Connor McDavid... So because there's so many Connor McDavids in this scenario,
yeah.
If you have a backup and a starter, both named Connor McDavid, that have the time, unencumbered time, to only focus on being a goaltender, you will have a good goalie. You'll have a good enough goalie that the rest of the Connor McDavids in front of you will bring it home.
I could see Connor like tinkering in his garage. Do you know what I mean? Repurposing one of those pitching machines to fire pucks at him, and it's going for hours and hours and hours on end, so he can perfect the goaltending position as well.
And this conversation, like it starts as just an absolute goof of an all Connor McDavid team, because like you start to think of, well, like the other team, if they play dump and chase, Connor McDavid would be so good at retrieving pucks because you would have two Connor McDavids always there before the forechecker because they're way faster. Two Connor McDavids delivering cherry passes out of the zone. So it also brought up the question of, if at this point, right now in his career, Connor McDavid decided, you know what? I'm done playing forward. The Oilers need a defenseman. I'm playing D. Would he be able to do what Dustin Byfuglien and Brent Burns did and completely reinvent himself to become a defenseman? Like, how good of a D-man would he be? Because he has all this natural skill, the passing ability, the skating, jumping up in the rush. Could he be like an Erik Karlsson?
I'll tell you one thing. Nobody would ever beat him to an icing.
Right? He'd be dangerous jumping up in the rush. He'd be dangerous passing out of his own end. Like, if you gave him a season to work on it, would Connor McDavid eventually be a top-pairing D-man is sort of the question.
Yes.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely. I think so.
This is a non-fucking starter. So, where this comparison is different than, I guess, baseball is because pitching is a completely different beast. But even though fucking Trout's got a hose on him, too, so...
And that was the argument...
Maybe he could be... So where could be a good pitcher.
Tyler, where did that team, like in this scenario, where did the Mike Trout team go wrong? Was it the pitching?
It was, they would literally lose games. They would give up 60 runs in some games. Like they would just get killed in the pitching because this Mike Trout only could throw like an 80 mile an hour fastball and a 70 mile an hour changeup because that's all the game said he knew as a position player. Whereas in real life, I actually called the author of this. I did an interview with him and he was like, in real life, the pitcher Mike Trout, there's 13 of them on the roster. They're all going to learn their own pitches. They're not just, they're going to eventually throw harder. They're eventually going to have strategy. They're eventually going to learn, you know, a slider or a curveball to mix things up. And that's where I think like just simming it on a video game is like so obviously vastly different from real life in this horrendously hypothetical situation where like Connor McDavid would eventually get better at playing defense throughout the year.
Can I just say this conversation is fucked?
It is.
It's great. It's fantastic.
It is absolutely.
It just
kind of
reminds
quarantine.
Me too of like, yeah. Wait, well, what do you think about Jose Bautista? He wants to come back as a pitcher.
What?
Yeah, man. He's like good too. Marcus Stroman like keeps going online. Apparently, Bautista's trying to become a two-way player so he can help the Dominican Republic qualify in the World Baseball Classic or for the Olympics, I believe. And he's like developed a low 90s sinker. He's got like a mid 90s fastball. And Marcus Stroman says Jose Bautista is better than than some pitchers in the majors already. Like, so these professional athletes, man, I think it, you know, LeBron James, I'm of the belief LeBron James could have made the NFL. He might have not been amazing, but that guy's work ethic, his natural abilities, and his athleticism could have gotten him to the NFL if he wanted to. I just think with these high end athletes, they can almost do anything they put their minds to.
It's been a while since we've seen a multi-athlete or a multi-sport athlete too.
The most recent one
like
would
Bo
be...
knows. Bo still knows.
Fuck, I love Bo Jackson.
Kyler Murray could have. I mean, he was a top 10 pick in the MLB, said no to the Oakland A's, and went first overall in the NFL to be a starting quarterback as a rookie. But it just doesn't
Rusty
exist
William.
Anymore. Yeah, Russell Wilson.
Mahomes.
There's a few
Mahomes
of them.
Too.
Yeah, Mahomes was a pitcher coming through. He could have probably gone pro. Like, I don't know. I think with the Connor McDavid, like, learning to play defense and all that, if people dismiss it, like, you just kind of need to think about it for 5 minutes and you go, you know what? I wouldn't bet against some of these elite athletes changing course.
Of all the people in the NHL that could learn another position, I believe Connor McDavid is the one that I would vote as somebody to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. If all of a sudden Connor just wakes up one day, let's say it's, and he decides, you know what? I've won every trophy the NHL has to offer except a Norris. I want to go for it. Yeah, I wouldn't bet against him.
I might not bet on him, but you're right. I wouldn't be like, well, that's impossible. Like he might just put up so many points that you couldn't ignore him. Like imagine him quarterbacking a power play and he works on his slap shot a bit and he's just got a cannon from back there.
You know what? It's comical when you see Connor McDavid take a slap shot because not that it looks bad, it just never happens. You're like, what is he doing with his body right now?
Well, we were talking about learning new pitches. Wait till he adds that one into the old repertoire because I feel like that's going to open up even more goals for the guy.
Oh yeah,
yeah. If he can get going like Dreisaitl has with that like low bottom of the circles area one timer, like if McDavid can perfect one of those, dangerous 50 goal guy.
It reminds me of when everybody said Crosby when he was just coming into the league, he was only a passer, and then he's like, no, I'm going to work on my shot, and then he goes out and scores 50.
Yeah, so,
especially using the blade he uses. That fucking curve is disgusting.
While we keep moving along, going to give some love to some of our sponsors, obviously. Our friends over at Japa Machinery. Check them out on their Instagram at Japa Equipment. And the group over at Oodle Noodle, some fantastic charity stuff. We touched on it earlier in the week, Jay, but how's everything going over at Oodle Noodle?
Yeah, no, things are still going good. You know, it's been, ever since we made that announcement, it's been pretty well received. We've gotten a lot of good feedback from it. So we're just pumped that we're able to kind of use, you know, leverage Oodle Noodle during this time to kind of help out the community. So, you know, we're just super appreciative of everyone's support to allow us to do this. So, yeah, we're just going to keep on keeping on.
And our other sponsor, Nation Beer, I have heard that there is a duo heading up to Slave Lake right now to pick up batch number 2 and get it ready for deliveries.
Yeah, one fourth of the Real Life Podcast team is going up with Jared, our sales guy, to Slave Lake right now to pick up the beer. So what a could have made a movie about the journey those labels had to go through to get to their final destination. But miraculously, they showed up yesterday. So they're canning. They sent some videos today. They took some videos today of the beer being canned, which is great. So pre-launch has been launched online. We also are selling our, I guess they're originally playoff flags, but now they're going to be just get back to normal Mission 2020 community flags. Made those available for sale with the beer purchase through Dog Island. And if you buy it through the site, then you save on shipping because we are going to launch them on our store, but you got to pay like 10 or 12 bucks to get it shipped to you anyway. So, you know, it's another way to kind of get it to you for free. So Friday we're going to be going out and hitting the streets again, which is tomorrow, delivering beer, and I can't wait because I love driving around the city.
Just quickly, I forgot to order this time around. Where can I do it?
On the Dog Island website. I think it's dogisland.com or .ca.
And then just click on
shop, and then the first thing you see there is Nation Beer.
Ah, there we go.
And that'll get delivered. Sorry.
That'll get delivered to my house again?
That'll get delivered to your house again, and we're slowly gaining traction. We're getting more and more liquor stores picking it up. We've gotten to Lacombe. We've gotten to McLennan, Alberta. We've gotten to Bonnyville. We're getting sightings around Edmonton right now, which is super exciting. Little Guy Liquor in Sherwood Park, they stepped up big time. They bought like 25 or 20 flats right off from the get-go. It's starting to weave its web, which is fantastic. I'm super pumped to see. And, you know, I'm a big fan of the beer, so I'm going to keep yelling about it and drinking it on social media as much as I can.
Speaking of which, next Nation Happy Hour coming up tomorrow, which is Friday, and every Friday thereafter at 4:30 p.m. on the Oilers Nation Instagram, which is Nation_ON. Just fun time to chat to people. Last week, I got to talk to the folks at Dog Island about the hilarious label mishap. We checked in with Tyler, was there.
Hi.
I talked to young Coom this morning. Coom is going to try to be on tomorrow's episode as well. So I'm excited about it. I look forward to it every week.
And now let's end the show with our final segment. It's a new old segment that we're bringing back. It's kind of created for Chalmers. I feel like he'll be the king of this one, but let's keep it 100, boys. Let's give some takes. Bag Milk, do you have one or you want me to go first?
You go first and inspire me, buddy.
Okay. Well, I got two, but I'll start with this one. All right. Right. I'm going to keep it 100 on golf returning. And this is a very, very touchy subject, but here's what I'm going to go with it. Why are people getting upset about it now? I looked outside multiple times today. You can't golf right now, even if you wanted to. So everyone's fighting and yelling and saying that the government can't do it. The government should do it. Blah, 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 blah. It doesn't even matter for like another month, really, until these golf courses can get into good shape. So to me, everyone right now is just arguing about absolute nonsense. I understand that people want to play golf. I want to play golf. I'm desperately looking to get some physical activity. But at the same time, it's not even a question right now because it's shitty outside. When it gets good outside, then maybe we could start talking about this and having a debate. But it seems like to me, this is just people fighting online for no good reason because it shouldn't even be a question right now. So I think when it comes to the golf topic, I'm going to keep it 100 and say everyone just needs to take a step back for like 30 days.
I was actually surprised that golfing was the hill a lot of people want to die on.
Yeah.
There was a, like, I'm not a big golfer. I do enjoy golf. Do you know what I mean? But like, I was really surprised the levels of outrage I was seeing on social media yesterday.
It's a polarizing sport.
And it's a rich white guy sport is what basic premise is for some of the people that are angry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. People are.
Jay, you're a golfer. What do you think?
what do I think should be the decision?
Or just in general about the whole thing?
Well, everyone's just woke and triggered right now. So this is just something, this is a topic that people, and golf's just the victim, right? Like, this is just the topic that can smoke out both sides, and they're just going to go to war with each other because people right now have been living in like a stress situation ever since this pandemic kicked off. So we're super heightened right now. So I'm not surprised to see that. It could have been anything else, but golf is the sport we're going to beat up right now. You know, but I'm of the belief in whatever. Maybe it's selfish intentions because I golf is, I would like to have it back and just put some rules around it because there is so much distancing to be had, and it's just a way to get outside. Like, we have to keep remembering about the whole mental health aspect of all this. Staying cooped up is not good for the mind. So, you know, getting outside and getting grounded with Mother Nature is a very, very positive thing to have or to do. So I'm of the mind to, like, figure it out and let's try. But obviously, if someone gets sick, then you have to stop it. But I can understand both sides, but I would more want to focus on like the humanitarian side of this, in the sense of like, let's give this as an outlet for people to get outside and engage in some kind of activity outside of just walking around their neighborhood aimlessly. Like I do every day. I'm already at 12,000 steps just because I had phone calls and walked around. Like, it would be a nice outlet to have. And also why I'd also beat the drum that if they could create the biodome in which the NHL could come and play in North Dakota or whatever it is, I would beat that drum too, just because the whole mental health aspect of having sports back and to watch and to, you know, cheer for. Long-winded answer. I'm keeping it 100.
Do either of you guys have one, or am I going to get the lone soapbox this week?
If I'm keeping it 100, Tyler, I am tired of seeing all these fucking idiots that do not believe that there is something serious going on in the world right now, and still choosing to go about their lives as though there's nothing going on, forcing those of us that are taking it seriously to extend our stays inside. If I'm going to keep it 100, you fucking idiots need to stay inside so that we can reduce the overall length of time that we are stuck in our homes and not playing golf and not being able to do things like play slow pitch or hang out with our buddies or go to bars or go to restaurants or whatever you want to do. Listen, Tyler, I'm a single guy. You're moving in with a missus here soon. I'm trying to meet chicks right now. And if I'm keeping it 100, doing that is very difficult when I'm not allowed to go anywhere.
Accurate.
Fantastic. Tremendous. Jay, do you got one?
Yeah, I've got one. This is more for, so, you know, I'm involved with a few brands in the city and I like to rep them, but I also like to be aware there's other great businesses in our city and I like to support them as best as we can. And this one's more of a guilty pleasure, but if I'm keeping it 100, I need to tell Arby's to wake the fuck up and get on goddamn delivery so I can get you in my belly, in my quarantine life, in my house.
Amen.
Preach. I like that one.
Do you know how often people from Mill Woods and Sherwood Park are sending me screenshots of their ability to order Arby's via delivery? And it is just, it's cutting the knife. It is just twisting the knife in my broken, meatless soul. I live so close to an Arby's, but I don't leave my house often. and I would love nothing more than the ability for them to bring me those sweet, sweet meats.
How can you deny us? It's like with Oodle Noodle, like 90% of our business is delivery right now. So like just think about the opportunity.
Get on board, Arby's.
Wake up, Arby's. All right, there you go. That is Keeping It 100, brought to you by Nation Beer. Guys, I think that's going to do it for our Thursday edition. It was a shorthanded one, but I had a ton of fun. We got into some weird little rabbit holes on this one. So lots of hockey talk, but it was good. Thanks for your time today, guys.
Thank you. Everyone, thank you. Stay safe.
Yes, stay safe. For Japa Machinery, for our friends at Oodle Noodle, for Jay Bag Milk, I'm Tyler Rumchuk. Thanks for tuning in. This episode of Nation Real Life is over.
Great job on making it through the entire hour of the Real Life Podcast. Don't forget to like and subscribe wherever you get your podcasts from.